Welcome to SI Now. I'm Robin Lundberg here with Madeline Burke. We're talking to Von Miller, a possible rule change in the NBA, and Ronda Rousey on Raw, but want to remind you about SITV, our new premium network featuring exclusive content, documentaries, and your favorite sports movies. Look for it on Amazon channels or just Google SITV to start your free trial. But we start today, Madeline, with a familiar story in the NFL.
Yes, Monday, reports surfaced that the Texans would avoid protesters in free agency. And while the team denied the reports, Dolphins owner Stephen Ross told the New York Daily News, quote, all of our players will be standing. Now, players have said that the frustration is that the message behind the protest is getting lost in the minutiae. Why is this issue such a hot-button topic for NFL teams and owners?
I think it's one of two reasons. One, they're revealing something about themselves. Or two, they're worried about the bottom line. And the irony about the reaction that you see from NFL ownership here, whether it was Jerry Jones last year or maybe McNair now and Stephen Ross, is they seem to be far more obsessed with this issue than it is as a relevant talking point at the moment. And let me be very clear. I don't want to devalue at all what the players took this stance for, but you just said it. A lot of these players believe the message is being lost, whether it was Trump trying to appropriate it or something else. And this wasn't really a story as the NFL season went along. How many times did you hear about it in the playoffs? How many times did you hear about it in the Super Bowl? Yet we're hearing about it now solely because of the owners and the league itself. So they keep wanting it to go away, yet they keep being the ones that are putting it in the headlines.
Yeah, and I think, you know, the saddest part about this is that the movement started for a very positive cause, and it is taken on a lot of negative light because of the misinterpretation of it. And I can see why people are saying, let's stay away from this, but I think there should be another way to keep the conversation going, because this is a very prominent issue that needs to be addressed in a way that isn't distracting.
Well, people are being obstinate on purpose. Let's keep it real. The players have communicated it. They have said it in front of microphones. They've talked about it. They've written articles about it. Yet people still won't talk about what their message actually is. So for that to be misinterpreted to that degree,
exactly,
you have to be doing it on purpose.
Yeah.
You have to be doing it on purpose. From the NFL to the NBA, where the association might be overhauling one of its rules in a move that could have major ramifications in the basketball world. Adam Silver and company are looking at adjusting the one-and-done age limit and providing players under 19 or less than a year removed from high school with an alternate path to the NBA rather than college and a way to earn a salary either from NBA teams or an enhanced G League. Do you like the direction the NBA is heading here, and what do you think the impact might be?
I do like the direction. I love the direction. I mean, Adam Silver has been one of the most forward-thinking commissioners in this sport. He's been very positive impact on the NBA in his time at the head chair. And I mean, you know, this one-and-done rule was put in place in David Stern's time to help, you know, the team save themselves from a bad investment or a player who's not quite ready to be at the professional level. They needed to be groomed. But if the college landscape is strictly being used as a grooming ground for the NBA, I mean, these under-the-table payments are benefiting everyone but these young players. And there's a lot of money being made on the backs of these young players and putting out this talent. And if there's another way, because there are some people who say, yes, you know what, I want to play basketball as a way to get an education. I want to play basketball as a way to pay for my higher education. But some people are saying, you know what, I'm just going to spend a year at this university or that university just as a step to the NBA. And, you know, I'll take a couple classes here and there and do my credits, but I am strictly focused on getting to the NBA. And for those people, having an alternate route is a very positive idea.
As much as I sit here and talk about the NCAA being broken, I'd be remiss if I didn't talk about the NBA's role in it, right? Because this rule helps to facilitate some of the corruption that's going on. So credit to the NBA for addressing it, because the NBA always seems to be wanting to move forward and innovate a little bit. And, you know, the idea that guys can't go from high school to professional basketball is a misnomer. We've seen
right.
it happen. For every Kwame Brown, you've got Kobe Bryant and Kevin Garnett and LeBron James and so on
yeah.
and so forth. I think the ultimate ramifications, though, Madeline, are if so many guys view this as an alternative, the top level talent stops going to college basketball, what happens then? Is there a middle ground between the NBA and college basketball that could actually rival the NCAA?
Right, and that is something to be addressed by college basketball. If they want elite level performance from their players, they need their players to benefit in an elite way as well.
We're always searching for a way to fix college basketball. Well, the search for the savior of the Cavs season continues. And last night, Larry Nance Jr. put his name in the mix, making his presence felt in his first Cavaliers start, making him our adrenaline performer, presented by Toyota. Let's go places. Nance set career highs with 22 points and 15 rebounds in a Cavs blowout of the Pistons, but Nance's impact has not been limited to one game. LeBron James is plus 53 in the minutes he's played alongside Nance since the latter's Cleveland debut, and minus 29 when he hasn't been on the floor. The Cavs as a whole have a net rating of plus 17.5 with Nance on the court. I think Ty Lue is realizing who his best players are, and I don't believe Tristan Thompson will reclaim his starting spot when he returns from injury. Just how significant is Nance going to be for the Cavs' hopes this season?
I mean, I think it absolutely will be significant. If last night was any testament to it, I mean, he played the most minutes of any Cav. By halftime, he had 18 points, 10 rebounds. He had a career night in that role, and he's helped elevate this team on the offensive end, on the defensive end. I think there's no question whether or not he's going to provide an impact here.
Yeah, you don't want to oversell Larry Nance individually, though. I think he's an excellent player.
But his role fits well with what they're trying to do.
He fits perfectly with LeBron. He doesn't need the ball in his hands. He does all of the stuff that, you know, is the intangible box score stuff. And he spaces the floor with his ability to rise up and yam it on people.
He is the perfect accessory for what they're trying to do right now, and he's fitting well in the system.
Some controversy surrounding the super fight taking place on Cinco de Mayo is Canelo Alvarez, who is training for his rematch with Gennady Golovkin, has tested positive for the banned substance clenbuterol. As of now, there is no word on how it might affect the fight, but how big a deal is this?
I think it's not a big deal yet. It could be a big deal, but again, Golovkin's camp is not quite pressing on this. They're not quite saying this is urgent yet. They're waiting for the Nevada Commission to do their job. And again, the amount is consistent with meat contamination that has affected athletes in Mexico and in China. So if it's coming from the meat, that's one thing. If it's coming from a banned substance, that's another. Until we know more, I think it's important to explain the nuance of this, but also to pump the brakes on this.
And Alvarez has tested, you know, negative in the past.
Exactly.
It's not like he has a history of this.
Exactly. All right. Well, Ronda Rousey's WrestleMania 34 match is now official. The former UFC superstar will team with Kurt Angle to take on Stephanie McMahon and the Triple H in mixed tag team match. Now, Monday night, we saw a little bit more of Ronda's repertoire. That mean mug is pretty strong. But how well is she adjusting to her new sport?
I think pretty well. She was criticized a lot for her lack of mic skills in her big debut. But look at this. This is a great Samoan drop. She's executing perfectly. So the in-ring portion she already has down. She has that menacing nature coming from a mixed martial art background. We know that her grappling, her judo skills will translate. She can put people in submission holds. So if she can just get that character down pat, she'll be good money. And people are being highly critical because she's such a big star, but she improved a lot from the last time to this time. So I think she'll get there where she'll have that proper mix of menacing and charisma.
That mean mug, like I said earlier, is strong. The character, I think, is there. I mean, we've seen her acting skills a little bit on display, and, you know, she's got that pageantry going. I think it'll work out well.
And no one's going to knock her down like Holly Holm, at least not, you know, for real. We've talked about some significant news in the NFL. Madeline had a chance to talk to Von Miller about those stories and his new studio show, Studio 58.
Pro Bowl linebacker Von Miller is here in studio. Von, Super Bowl champion, MVP, Dancing with the Stars. Now you've got your own show on Facebook, Studio 58 on Facebook. You've done some ridiculous stuff on here, zookeeping, collecting sports memorabilia. First of all, we got to take a quick look at this promo. Let's see what this looks like.
Howdy. This is Von Miller, Studio 58.
How about a Vontage?
Yeah, Vontage.
It's Von Miller here coming to you live from my basement. We got a lot of cool stuff going on.
A lot of cool stuff, y'all. Oh!
The only limit is my imagination.
That was quite the Vontage right there.
Yeah, it's a good Vontage.
All right, so Studio 58, Wednesdays at 8 p.m. on Facebook. You can watch it there. How did you come up with the idea for the show?
It's something I wanted to do for, two or three years now. It's basically Von Miller Studio 58 in the locker room every single day. And I just wanted to find a way to bring that to my fans. Facebook Watch, it gives me a platform where I can connect with all of my fans in a unique way. And it's a cool, special thing, and I'm really excited about it.
And it's been a very unique way. You've had a lot of guests. You've had a lot of adventures through this show. One of your interviews was with Jalen Ramsey, and he taught you how to trash talk a little bit. Are you going to use that on the field next season?
Oh, I don't know if I'm going to use it, but it was definitely, interesting to get that perspective from Jalen. I don't really trash talk at all, but you meet with a guy like Jalen, and he gives you tips on how he trash talks. He's the best at it. It was definitely a fun interview.
What makes him the best at trash talking?
Because he's good.
He backs it up.
Because he's really, really talented, and he backs it up. And when you can you know, walk it how you talk it. You know, it's a beautiful thing.
Exactly. Like Migo said it best, right? Yeah. All right, so you pulled the fans in one of your episodes for a new catchphrase. I'm sure you got a lot of responses. What were some of the most memorable responses you got out of that?
I think good night, quarterbacks.
All right.
That was a good one. And I think just people interacting live with the show is definitely a new, you know, thing. You really don't have a live show over the internet where fans can interact live as well. So it's just a cool thing to be a part of, you know, Facebook Watch.
Has this opened your eyes at all to just how many fans and what an impact you have on NFL fans out there?
I mean, it's something that I already knew.
I mean, you got to be aware of that.
Yeah, I mean, it's something that I already knew, and I just wanted to be able to give back to those guys and interact with those guys, and Facebook Watch definitely allows me to do that.
Yeah. Now, the combine recently happened. You tweeted out recently that Shaquem Griffin impressed you, saying, I would love to play with this guy. Mm-hmm. Now, you play linebacker. You know what it takes to play the position at an elite level. What would you say to those who say that having one hand is a hindrance for Griffin?
I don't think I have to say it at all. I mean, you know, Shaquem, he said it, and he's done it all. That's the type of team that you want to build. You want, high character guys, guys with big hearts, guys that's going to leave it all out there in the field. That's what makes a team, a foundation of players like that. That's what makes you a Super Bowl champion team.
Yeah, but like the technicality of it too. I mean, I know linemen, you need to kind of grab and kind of have mm-hmm. your hands as well. But he's not really one to let guys get out of a tackle and stuff like that. How have you seen him be able to do that?
I don't know. You just watch in amazement. You know, he definitely gets it done. I saw him at the Senior Bowl. I saw him at in his bowl game as well. He definitely gets it done. It's not like you can tell that he has one hand out there, and he's just playing lights out. He went to the combine, he performed lights out, and you know, a guy like that, I would love to play with.
Yeah, definitely. Some people are saying that he's as inspiring as John Wooden in a room, which is pretty mm-hmm. crazy. Now, Roger Goodell yesterday went viral for running a 40 yeah. in a suit. He went 5'4", 140. How impressed are you that he was able to do that while wearing a suit like this?
You know what? I'm impressed that he didn't run into the cubicle.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to run straight. It's hard to run fast and straight like that.
Exactly.
And, you know, he definitely did it. It would have been terrible if you'd ran to, you know, the printer right there, or, you know, that, somebody.
Yeah, the printer. Then
he's winded, too. He's winded, too.
Easy load letter. I know.
I mean, it's dope whenever you see the head, man, you know, whenever you see guys like that get involved with what we do, it's always cool.
Do you look at Goodell and think, okay, this guy has that athleticism?
No. But it's cool to see him run, though. And I haven't seen any of my coaches run.
Right.
Or my head coach run. So.
Right.
You know, to see the head man do that is definitely cool.
That could be a good challenge to put out there during training camp or something like that, maybe. How fast do you think John Elway would run a 40?
I don't know. We won't see John run.
No. He's past that stage.
Yeah, John too cool. John too cool to run. He can walk wherever you want to go.
That's true. He'll strut, right?
Yeah.
Von Miller, thank you so much for taking the time, promoting the show, the whole wide spectrum. NFL training camp is, you know, going to be here pretty soon.
Yeah,
but until then.
It's a long way away.
Until then, we can keep up with you on Facebook Wednesdays at 8 p.m. Eastern. Watch on Facebook.
Conference tournaments start today, so we now welcome in our college basketball analyst Dan Green to go over the biggest thing to watch from each conference and how it could affect the NCAA tournament. Dan, let's start with the ACC.
In the ACC, the most interesting team to me is Notre Dame. They were a top five team earlier this year. They lost Bonzi Colson, their best player, one of the best players in the country, for 8 weeks with a broken foot. He came back last week, and now they're probably firmly on the wrong side of the bubble right now. They're 18-13. At full strength, they can win a couple games in the ACC and kind of win their way into the tournament. And if they do so, if they get in there as, you know, like an 11 seed, they're way better than most 11 seeds that we're used to seeing. So they can end up being a really dangerous team in there. But, you know, they really have to kind of earn their way in the ACC tournament.
What are you watching in the Big East?
If we get another Xavier-Villanova matchup, that could be really interesting to me. Xavier won the Big East in the regular season. They went 15-3, but two of those losses were to Villanova in their two meetings, and they're both by double digits. So Xavier is a team that is looking like a probable one seed right now. They have some very realistic Final Four aspirations, but they haven't gotten over that hump against the other elite team in their league. And so if those two teams meet again, it'll be on Saturday night at the Garden in the Big East Finals. It could be a lot of fun to watch.
How about the Big 12? I imagine you'll be watching Trae Young and Oklahoma very closely.
Yes, yeah, they're a very interesting team, kind of similar to Notre Dame in that they started off the season so strong and then faded, but in their case it wasn't injuries, it was just things kind of went haywire. Trae Young slowed down a little bit. They started off 14-2. They're 4-10 since mid-January. So they got Oklahoma State up in their first game in the Big 12 tournament. They split with them in the regular season. If they win that game, that would be a step in the right direction, but they'll probably have to win, you know, maybe two to really feel like they're on solid ground going into the tournament. And again, they're a team, because of Trae Young, that not a lot of teams are going to want to see, but things have just kind of fallen off lately, and they're going to have to get back on the right track.
What about Pac-12 Conference of Champions right there?
Yeah, Arizona obviously is something to watch because of everything going on there, and they're one of the best teams in the country. But behind them is kind of this bubble free-for-all. You have Arizona State, who's another team that started off very strong and kind of faded along the way. But then you have UCLA, USC, Washington, Utah, and all these teams are trying to kind of jockey for position on that bubble. So you're going to see some quarterfinals, some semifinals between these teams with a little added oomph to them. And if any of those teams were to win the Pac-12 and get that automatic bid, any of those teams but Arizona, that's going to be something that they really need. And there's a little bit of added stakes to the Pac-12 tournament for most of the teams.
How about the SEC? Is this one a bit of a duh?
Kentucky. You're always watching Kentucky, and especially a Kentucky team like this that's been kind of so all over the map this year. We all know they're incredibly young. They got a nice jolt from Jared Vanderbilt getting healthy towards the end of the year, gave them some rebounding and some toughness edge that they could use. But yeah, they recently won three in a row, then they lost four in a row, and then they won four in a row after that. So they've been a tough team to kind of read the temperature on, so to speak. It depends on when you were trying to take that temperature this year. This is the most important time to take it. So to see how they're able to do in a tournament setting this week could give us some insight into how they'll do in the NCAAs. And then also a little bonus thing is Michael Porter Jr. with Missouri. He's been cleared to practice. There's talk of he might be returning for the SEC tournament. They're probably already in the NCAAs, but getting their best player back would be a big boost.
All right, Dan, give us one team from the right side of the bubble and one team on the wrong side right now, unless something crazy happens.
Team on the right side right now is probably Kansas State. They've quietly built up a pretty nice resume. They don't really have any of those big signature wins, but they went 10-8 in the Big 12. They finished fourth in the league, and obviously a high-quality league. And so they probably right now are feeling like they should feel like they're pretty solid heading in to next week. Beating TCU in their first Big 12 game would go a long way to help that. Then on the wrong side of the bubble, a double dip of Big Ten teams with Penn State and Nebraska, both 120 games this season. When you see that from a Big Ten team, that's usually a pretty good sign. But neither of them really built up the kind of resume, besides that you need to get in. Penn State, they beat Ohio State twice, but they had a lot of rough losses this year. They lost to Rider at home. They lost to Wisconsin at home. They lost to Minnesota at home. And so that kind of offsets some of the good done by beating Ohio State. And then with Nebraska, they really only beat one tournament team this year in Michigan. They didn't do themselves any favors in the Big Ten tournament last week, going 1-done, losing to Michigan by 19 points in their first game. So unfortunately for both these teams, the Big Ten tournament ended a week earlier than usual. They've now got a longer wait to find out what Selection Sunday holds for them, but I don't think it's going to be too good news for either.
Dan Green, thank you so much for the insight.
Thanks for having me.
We now welcome in our legal expert Michael McCann to go over a sex discrimination lawsuit filed against ESPN by former employee Adrienne Lawrence in Connecticut on Monday. Michael, I've seen discussions on this range from a legitimate company concern for ESPN to accusations made by a jilted former employee. In your opinion, what exactly is going on here?
Well, Robin, we don't know. I think that's the honest answer, that we have a set of allegations in a federal complaint. Some of those allegations are extremely disturbing. Whether or not there's evidence and testimony that corroborate them is a separate issue, and it may take some time before we know the truth. I am sure there will be responses. We've already seen some employees raise serious questions about the veracity of some of the details, but there are a lot of details in this complaint. I mean, it's a 93-page complaint, so it's a situation where even if some of it is true, it would be pretty disturbing and potentially unlawful for ESPN.
Now, you mentioned the complaints about some of the details, one of the details being a voicemail that Chris Berman reportedly left for Jemele Hill. But Jemele denied that part of the story, saying that while she and Berman did have a conflict years ago, the way it was characterized in this is, quote, dangerously inaccurate. and that there were no racially disparaging remarks on her voicemail. Rather, the conflict was handled professionally by ESPN. Now, she goes on to allude that Lawrence is misrepresenting this for personal gain. How does that affect the credibility and plausibility of this suit?
Yeah, it certainly undermines both the credibility and plausibility of the suit. Although I think we'd want to see if Jemele Hill would say the same things under oath. I mean, this is, again, a situation where when one makes a comment to the media, it's not under oath. And would Jemele Hill respond the same if in a deposition under cross-examination from one of Lawrence's attorneys? I don't know. I'm not saying she wouldn't. But the circumstances of that denial, I imagine the lawyers would argue, are not the same as would be true if it were under oath. So it's very undermining of the lawsuit, but I would put an asterisk next to that because of the context in which the comments were raised.
Michael McCann, thank you as always for the insight on this developing legal story.
Thank you.
I'm here with USA gold medalist curler John Shuster, and we're going to play a little shuffleboard. You think you got me?
Yeah, I think I did.
You were in SI's Faces in the Crowd in 2004, I believe.
Yeah.
What's it like to go from that to this right now?
I guess it's pretty surreal. I mean, Faces in the Crowd, one little blip, you know, talking about, you know, young people that are kind of up and coming in their sports. The funniest thing on that same page of Faces in the Crowd was a teammate of our now sports psychologist that was with us here at the Olympics.
So, oh, wow.
Yeah, because she was a gymnast at UCLA. So one of her teammates was actually in that same exact issue of SI and Faces in the Crowd with me that one year. So,
what's the biggest misconception about your guys' story and curling in general, would you say?
I think, you know, one of the big misconceptions is that, you know, our team, like the mirror curl on ice, what they're claiming it, but
that's the title of the movie, by the way.
Okay, fair enough. But it's one of those things, like, our team's been to three straight world championships, and in those three world championships, we finished in the top five out of 12 teams. It wasn't as far of a reach as a miracle.
Is it different than you expected, or was winning the gold medal and everything that came along with it what you expected?
You know, I think it's a little bit different. You know, for me, like, once we got up there, just like, there's just so much satisfaction. I think I was surprised that it wasn't quite as emotional as I had thought it might be. You know, it's been really, really crazy to think of, like, how much attention you actually get when, you know, all this has been going on. Oh.
What's the craziest thing or person that has said something to you, congratulated you? What's the, like, moment that stands out the most?
You know, it's, I think I laugh at when I, you know, look at some, like, Twitter things, and it's always fun to read those Twitter bios, like, I was wrong about John Shuster kind of thing.
I was a lot better at this before you showed up. I'm not kidding.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, I guess I have to participate in the Dick's Sporting Goods Contenders program to get better. How did that help your Olympic experience?
You know, like, for me, when the Dick's Contenders program started in September of, 16, mm-hmm. and it was hard to get to the gym and go to practice with one child is okay because you only had one to worry about, and all of a sudden we had two of them under the age of three, and I was able to actually, like, make enough money, and they're super flexible with time, and we were able to put our kids in daycare a few days a week on days where my wife actually worked, and it allowed me to actually train how I needed to to be where I wanted to be. So I think that's game, man.
I think that is game. What do you call these things? Chips? Pucks? What are
pucks,
they called?
I think.
Pucks are a little bit closer to the point system there. John Shuster, Olympic gold medalist, USA Curling. It's official. We're 100 days away from the beginning of the 2018 World Cup. In light of this, we have Fox Sports studio host Rob Stone with us. And Rob, with Neymar opting to get surgery on his broken foot, the timetable several months, will this help hurt their chances in this Cup and keep them from him contributing in Russia?
We'll have to see. It's one of those tricky little injuries on an outside toe. And yeah, you're right. The time frame they're giving him is a couple months that will pretty much butt into almost the start of the World Cup. But he's one of the icons playing right now. Look, you're always going to take Neymar, whether he's at 20% or 100%. You're going to want him on your team. He's the leader of Brazil. my guess is he's going to be fit, and they're going to kind of work him slowly through the group stage into the games that really matter. Look, Brazil should storm through the group stage. Brazil should be quarterfinalists, semifinalists. They should be there in the title game as well. So I think they have some time to fully acclimate Neymar. And again, I think Brazil is one of the clear favorites to maybe knock off Germany this summer at the World Cup.
Well, you mentioned that they should storm through the group stage, but if they're the off chance that he isn't fully healthy and isn't fully fit and ready to go, can they do this?
They're Brazil.
Yeah, I know,
right?
They're
Brazil, right?
It's
they've got 100 other one-name guys that are fantastic and are going to be stellar. But again, it's Neymar, you know?
Yeah.
And we really live in this golden age in soccer where we have so many absolute icons playing in their prime between Ronaldo and Messi and Neymar. And then there's a list of other guys that are so dang good right now, but they can't get the exposure because of the big three right now. Brazil, I don't think they should be worried. I think they would prefer it if Neymar was fully healthy, but they have so much talent from back all the way up to front that they're always going to be a contender.
So it's been rough for Neymar, but it's been really rough for French superstars as well, as Benjamin Mendy and Dembele have been plagued with injuries, while Pogba and Bakayoko have struggled as of late. Come World
Cup
time.
You just threw those names out.
He's like, let me get through this.
He's ready for the World Cup. I love it.
You said one name.
Go,
these
Robin.
Are a little
yeah,
bit more difficult.
Man.
Will this stacked French team be able to put everything together?
It's more of a mental question. I think the French have had a history of imploding when they're supposed to be really good. And I feel like they go through these four-year cycles like, we're a team, we're a unit, we're going to be great, and then we're going to have some issues. And that's the question. They have the talent for it, absolutely. I don't think enough people, frankly, are talking about a France or a Belgium to go the distance this summer in Russia, because I think there's the mental concerns, the locker room concerns about how are all these stars going to come together and work together. Spain naturally gets the guys together. Same with the Germany and the Brazil. I think that's why they're easy to list them as favorites. But Belgium and France still have a lot to prove off the field.
Now, obviously, the 2018 World Cup is just around the corner. But looking ahead, have you heard any updates on the U.S. Morocco 2026 bid?
You know, that's going to be announced the day before the World Cup kicks off. And, you know, without the U.S. men's national team being in the World Cup this summer, that is arguably the biggest day in American soccer history for the next couple years, because what comes with it, you know, an expanded World Cup in 2026 that goes to 48 teams, hosting at three countries for the first time ever, Canada, Mexico, and the lion's share in the United States. The eyeballs that come with it, the media attention that comes with it, the sponsorship that comes with it. This is more than just a soccer moment for the United States. This is a financial moment for the United States as well. With all those companies out there, we'll be willing to reinvest back into the sport. Also, I think it's a great carrot for the kids out there, for our kids, for the grandkids out there to say, I might be able to represent my country like some of our greats did in 1994. And I can see some daylight at the end of the tunnel. And I've got this carrot out there to try and represent my country on my home soil.
Yeah, obviously, potentially a huge get for the U.S. 2018 World Cup, though, a huge get for Fox. The largest production in Fox Sports' 24-year history. You can watch the tournament on Fox and FS1 from June 14th to July 15th. Rob Stone, thank you so
Can't
much
wait.
For the
Thanks
time.
For having me, guys.
That'll do it for us here today.
You don't want to say any other soccer names?
Neymar.
I feel like we got to
round
an
easy one.
No, you got to get the syllables
Pogba,
going.
Pogba, Bakayoko. Dembele, yeah. Right?
That's good. And you're looking at me. You're not even cheating anymore. This is pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, I got to get the prep in. We got 100 days. 100 days for
Russia,
you to get
you're
ready.
On the clock. 100 days.
In the meantime, every week on SITV, you've got Planet Football for your latest soccer news. And every day for all your news and sports, you can check us out right here on at SI Now, live 10:30 a.m. Eastern Time.